From the Denver Broncos Media Center, welcome to Broncos Country Tonight.
Welcome to Broncos Country Tonight, as the Broncos have introduced their new head coach, Sean Payton, to the media as well as the rest of Broncos Country to help me break down his comments. Benjamin Allbright, back from his trip from Mobile. How you doing, Ben?
I'm doing pretty well. About yourself?
I'm very good, man. Very good. Very entertaining press conference as we literally just stepped away from it. What were some of your takeaways?
I think he did really well, and you'd expect a head coach, somebody who'd been in the league for 15 years and had TV experience, to do really well. I thought he did well. I thought he acknowledged the negatives and turned them into positives. You know, I mean, again, like, I don't want to keep harping on this, but he very clearly put out the, well, yeah, you know, we're not each other's first choice, but that doesn't matter anymore. We're here now, and now it's about the product on the field. And that's what I tried to tweet about that the other day, but it's good to hear him say it and good to see it and pivot forward. Whether you're somebody's first choice or not, you know, Doug Peterson wasn't the first choice in either Philly or Jacksonville, and I think both those places have been happy with the results that they've gotten so far. So, you know, I think that I think he said the right things. Talked about accountability, talked about attention to detail, talked about the things that matter. Didn't seem in over his head to start. That's certainly more solid ground to stand on than perhaps the last couple of coaches.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of confidence there. There's no doubt about that. And I think that's confidence from experience more than anything, and confidence in who he is and what he wants to do. And the, as you mentioned, the attention to details, the discipline that he wants to be at the forefront of what the Broncos do going forward. And I think that when you're taking a look at what Sean Payton did to get to here, as you acknowledged there, that he said, hey, maybe I wasn't the first choice, but that doesn't really matter at this point. That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly where I think we can all just sort of say that was a footnote in the whole coaching search, and we move forward because this is the coach, and this is what you hope that he's going to bring, the kind of winning, as he talked about a ton throughout the course of the process of the interview or the press conference. That's what he's going to be bringing here. And I loved all the little anecdotal, the towel story, you know, talking about how we need bigger towels and those kinds of things. I think that's just another indication of what happens when you've been doing this a long time and you know exactly what you want.
Well, yeah, and it does, you know, it does speak to an attention to detail. Most people wouldn't talk, well, they're just towels, it's whatever, you know. No, if we're going to do this, we're going to do it right, you know, from the get-go. And I think that's the right thing. There are no shortcuts to winning. Even doing things the right way all the time doesn't necessarily lead you to a Super Bowl. So if you're shortcutting yourself, all you end up doing is cheating yourself. And so I think that I think he's going to reestablish that baseline. You know, we're going to go every, you know, you're not going to stop. You're going to go every inch with the hustle. You're going to run every route all 100% all the time. We're not going to, well, we don't need to do this when it's just a practice. No, you practice it the way you play it. And so, you know, I think that's going to be it. I think, I've talked to people who've worked with Coach Payton before, and what they told me is when you get out there on the practice field, once you see that chest puff up, that's when you're time to turn your head, duck, and get out of the way, because he's about to light into somebody. So,
but again, he even said that this isn't going to be for everybody. Like, mm-hmm. There's a certain amount of toughness that he needs to bring this team up to, mm-hmm. and there's a certain amount of work that needs to happen. And he said it's just not going to be for everybody. He mm-hmm. used the example of when he first got to New Orleans in 2006 and how really there were only a few guys left over from that team that won the championship because they had to, and we see overhaul on every roster every year, but there was a type of player he was looking for. There's a type of personality, mm-hmm. there's a type of toughness that he's looking for. And so it is incumbent on these guys that are in the building already. Okay, well, either I'm getting on the same page with the coach, and this is like every single time there's a new coach, or I'm on my way. And I think that's the one thing that we're maybe lacking a bit over the last few years. It was sort of let's try to make it work with every single type of personality, every single type of work ethic, when there's an inevitability where you have to really win in this league, you've got to nail it down to, we have one vision, one direction, and that's what we're going to work on.
Yeah, and I think that's it. I think now it's up to coach to come in there and set the baseline and set the standard and then set the vision of where they're going to go. And between him and George Payton, they'll work together to cobble a 90-man roster together, and they'll get the right people to do that. And here's the standard. And you know, if you meet it, then you're going to be on the 56. And if you don't, hey, we thank you kindly for trying, and we hope you find the best of luck somewhere else.
It was kind of a funny moment at the beginning of the press conference when he was asked about George Payton and that relationship, and I think he would use words like, everybody thinks I'm like some kind of tyrant and I'm going to come in here, but you just talked about it. It's when he gets up, that's when that those are some of the stories that you hear. Mm-hmm. So what do you think as we sit here right now? You saw the press conference with Greg Penner, Sean Payton, and George Payton. What do you think about that relationship with the GM?
I think they're going to be fine for now. You know, I mean, obviously this is going to be, this is in the honeymoon phase, right? So obviously that relationship is going to be fine. The question is going to be when, you know, if Sean Payton wants a player that they're unable to acquire, or they'd have to pay more than George Payton wants to pay for it, or, you know, those kinds of things. In the end, if they have a fundamental disagreement on what a player is that's either currently on this roster or they want on this roster, who's going to get the final say? And, you know, at the end of the day, I believe that should belong to George Payton, but Sean Payton has all the cachet right now. It might wind up being him.
Well, but he used the example of how him and Mickey Loomis, as well as ownership there with New Orleans, and how they would have discussions, and they there would be some debates, and there would be discussion, but they would always come to consensus. So I guess, like any organization, right, there are certain times you're working with people that don't have the same vision, but it doesn't mean that you can't figure things out. So I guess that's what you build on.
Right, and that's the thing. Like right now you're in the honeymoon phase, so everything's going to be all hunky-dory. The question is, once those disagreements come up, what direction does it tilt at that point, and are those disagreements insurmountable? And we don't know the answer to that, and they don't know the answer to that yet.
I liked his points about Russell Wilson when he was asked about it. It was kind of fascinating, though, because he made it sound like with Russ is like every other player. Like the quarterback is just like every other player. You're just trying to get the best out of them.
Mm-hmm.
And you're trying to put them in the best possible position to succeed. And so oftentimes we do focus in on the quarterback, and we talk about the quarterback in terms of it is unlike any other position in sports, really, right? Mm-hmm. But even in the NFL locker room, I guess you have to, at a certain level, be a coach and say, listen, I understand the entourage. I understand that you're a celebrity, but there's a certain amount of you're a football player, and we need to focus in on you as a football player and getting the best out of you. But I also liked his karaoke sort of joke there that he talked about, where he said, you know, it's like going to karaoke and not knowing the words to the song you're about to sing.
Right.
And I thought that was such a great sort of appropriate way to frame sometimes how we watched Russell Wilson perform last year. Mm-hmm. It felt like he didn't really know the playbook, or didn't really know where his receivers were going to be, or his hot routes, and it felt disjointed at times, in part because Russ looked confused. So I thought that was just a clever way to sum up some of the things we saw with Russ.
Well, yeah, I think so. And there was, you know, to people who were wondering about special or preferential treatment in the media scrum after the press conference, he flat out said, you know, a couple of different things. One, he said he didn't think he would need somebody to come in and manage the clock for him. He thinks he could handle the play clock on his own. And two, he said that when asked about the office and the entourage and all that kind of stuff, he said, well, that's news to me, and I don't think that's going to be a thing we're going to be doing here. So for people that wanted those questions answered, there's your answer.
You got that. No doubt about that. A couple other things from the Sean Payton press conference. Again, I liked it, talking, you know, hearing from Greg Penner in the process, and knowing that it's different than anything he's ever experienced. And we knew that, right? But they also kind of acknowledged a little bit of how this, where we're not getting quite the transparency or insight via social media or via everything, this might actually be more of things to come. Like the way they're going to be operating is going to be a function of, we're trying to take care of everything behind the scenes, mm-hmm. and we're hoping that we can just basically let our wins on the field be the way we talk about it.
Well, and that is the direction that will be going forward, is the identity of this football team will be its success. Or, you know, hopefully not, it's failure. And so that's kind of what they want that to be. They want the on-field product to speak about that, and then they'll address, you know, the ownership will come in and address fan concerns and all that kind of stuff. You know, they're putting the money in the stadium and all that. But they want the on-field success to speak for itself, and the Broncos brand to be successful from winning on the field.
Yeah. So understanding that we're used to a little bit more transparency, at least last year, mm-hmm. a lot of videos, a lot of social, a lot of going behind the scenes. I mean, even the draft process was just, I mean, it was a lot of fun, right?
Right.
But the Broncos are going in a little bit of a different direction with that. So that's going to be a little bit of a change, I think, for Broncos fans too.
Yeah, I think so. And I think that if you look at, you know, you could kind of already see it through this process, through this hiring process. And I don't know if that's necessarily all Sean Payton. That might be ownership as well. But certainly Sean Payton will want a tighter rein on all the social and all that kind of stuff. And I think the fans who have become accustomed to a certain level of access may be a bit disappointed with that.
All right. So anything else that jumped out to you during the course of those conversations?
I thought he had a good attitude and demeanor about it, and I thought he did the right things as far as taking the negatives, addressing them on the front end, and turning them into positives. I mean, that's what they tell you to do from a PR standpoint, right? So coming out and saying, hey, look, without actually saying we weren't each other's first choices, but he very, very clearly alluded to it. And then saying that doesn't matter anymore. I thought that was great. I thought that was the note to end it on right there. I thought that was the one to say, okay, all right, cool. Now it's time to pivot. It's time to start winning football games.
My favorite little sort of anecdotal moment is when he was talking about how he's still doing some things for Fox and he's picking the Eagles.
Yeah.
And he's doing that in part because you can't pick the Kansas City Chiefs because they play in this division. Again, all the time we talk about the messaging, and I know it was a big sticking point for Alfred Williams on KOA, but the messaging from Nathaniel Hackett, for better or worse, when it came to the division rival games, that he kind of was just a little bit, he wasn't as all in as fans are. He was more of a, yeah, well, I have respect for them and somebody's got to win this game and those kinds of things. He did eventually pivot later, but the early messaging on some of the rivalry games wasn't that it was a rival. He didn't really think about it as a rival. Mm-hmm. But for the fans, especially in the midst of losing seasons and very little to look forward to at times, the rivalries matter a lot. And so that for me was just an early like way to hit the right, sort of strike the right chord with the fan base, is to say, yeah, the Eagles have to win this one because we cannot root for in-division rival to win the Super Bowl. And again, I know that you feel different about that because you tend to be like, no, I mean, let them win because then that's the team you got to beat.
Right.
Kansas City Chiefs are already the team you got to beat. You've lost 15 straight times to them. I don't think winning a Super Bowl makes that any better. Point being here, I thought that was the right thing to say to this fan base as an intro of like, no, I care about division rivals as much as you guys do.
I get that. And yeah, as far as fan service, yeah, I agree with it. In the end, I mean, you do want to, to me, it's sweeter to beat, beat the defending Super Bowl champ. I'm just that guy. Like, I want to beat champions. I don't want to beat plebes. I don't want to beat the
Giants. But there's 15 straight. I mean, you're going to beat them anyways, right? I mean.
So let them win the Super Bowl and then snap it then.
I'm just saying.
And to be fair, in the interest of full disclosure, I've got money on the Eagles in this game. But I'm just saying, like, for me, it's sweet. I want to beat champions. I don't want to beat the Josh McDaniels of the world all the time and puff my chest.
Remember you said.
See, that's fan service.
You used to say allegedly on all that. You don't have to say that anymore.
Yeah, I know. I love it.
That's great. All right. For Benjamin Albright, I'm Ryan Edwards. Thanks for watching Broncos Country Tonight.
Denver's going to win it! You can stand up with Jalen in Denver, and you've got the world champions that live in your town.